This is the best I can do. Anyway, guys, how's everybody doing? Y'all good?
Good.
Yeah.
Okay, so here's the thing. I can sit there and talk to myself naked in the bathroom all day long. In fact, I do. However, this is not about me. This is about y'all. So at any time in this little lecture presentation, whatever you want to call it, you guys want to interject or ask a question, men, raise your hands. Women, flash me. Y'all good? Men can flash me too, you won't get called on. So that's pretty much what this is. This is for you. And this is something, people call me a dream killer, a dream crusher, but when I've done consulting in the past, nobody hires a consultant to give good news. They want to hear it. And sometimes people get their feelings hurt when you tell them their company's a mess or their idea sucks. But that's why you're there. You're there to point out the inefficiencies within their organization. And you're there to provide options and to provide strategies and to provide information and insight on how they can turn that dream into reality. And about dreams, when I was in eighth grade, starting center on my basketball team in junior high, I was one of the taller kids. As you can tell, that didn't last. Sometimes dreams just aren't attainable. And sometimes you just scrap that dream and move on. However, I don't think anybody's here because they want to give up on their dream. I don't think anyone's here. I think everybody in here doesn't want to work a standard. Anybody here, right, show of hands, want to just work a 9-to-5 job, go home to your average life, and just die? Okay, you guys want great stuff in your life, right? You guys want to achieve greatness. And to achieve greatness, you have to start something. You don't just go, oh, fucking great. No, everybody from the best athletes to the bench warmer on a professional sports team has started somewhere and worked their way up. That's the thing. Nobody just ends up with greatness. And so today, for those of you who want to start your own business, for those of you who want to start something special, or maybe you just want to move up in life and get some more insight, I've put together this little presentation, The Art of the Startup, Sustaining the Startup. Because starting something is pretty easy. I get funding and start a company tomorrow. How do you make it work? How do you sustain it? And how do you do it without ruining your life? Which I have firsthand experience, I'll say. I've ruined my life many times. Probably ruining it right now. But we'll see how the Instagram Live goes. So without further ado, I'm going to move into this. Now again, the fun part is at the end, it's open Q&A. So you can ask me whatever you want. There's absolutely no limitations. Fitness, career, sexual positions, all things that I am well versed in. So about me. My man Shane, obviously already kind of laid this out there. CEO of Tiger Fitness, CMO of Tiger Fitness, CEO of MTS Nutrition, Ambrosia, Machine Training Solutions. I still do some coaching, and I also do a bunch of other stuff that I'm not going to waste your time talking about. First company I started in 2004 was Cybation and Primal Force as well. I sold that in 2011, and here I am now with this company. So that was my first, we were the first to launch an intro workout product called Extend, not the penis enhancer, although it would have probably made more money if it did make your penis grow. That was my first company, founder, launched that category. When you create a category, that'll really, really, really give you a head up on the competition, because the first to market is the first to mine. So when you think intro workout, it's still the leading intro workout in the industry. I don't want to connect to the app store. My bad. Wow, this mouse is a big reach. Okay, founding shareholder, so now my little thing with Sylvester Stallone. After you go to school, I got fired. So there's a failure right there. Media Publications, American Media, where I started my career. I started in advertising, worked my way up in American Media. By the age of 24, I was pretty much at the top of corporate America. It was a very, very, very lucrative thing. Don't read the comments. Instagram Live gets crazy, bro. So nonetheless, so that was where I started my career, so to speak. I'm a mediocre pro bodybuilder, which is why I'm covered up right now. I'm a husband and father of three. And I just put that there because I've been on TV, even though the show failed miserably. I was on American Grid. I wasn't really the star. It was 1 of 16, and then there were a bunch of other people who were more well-known. But I lasted a solid 3 episodes before I found out I had no balance. So anyway, so the art of the startup. I'd like to start with the negatives. If anybody, any questions about my past before we get on? No? Good? Okay, cool. No flashing? Okay, nonetheless. The downsides. Businesses have a 94% failure rate. 94% of all businesses fail. So let's just think of it that way. Let's go back to the unprotected sex. If you had a condom that had a 94% failure rate, would you use it? Okay, we all don't use them anyway, I get it. But that's a pretty bad rate. So here's the deal. Like, what makes you think that you're gonna come in not knowing an industry and just bam, start a business and be in the 6% that make it? It's why when people ask me, hey, what tips do you have to start a business in industry X? Or who's the main distributor in this industry? If you're not an expert at that industry, if you're not an expert, you're going up against experts. So your chances of failure are much higher. No life. You think college is hard? It is. I mean, I'm not gonna lie. You have to study and drink, have a bunch of promiscuous sex. I get it, college is tough. But you have no life. I mean, if you're gonna have a business that works, I mean, you know, how much time do you have to yourself?
0 hours.
Yeah, exactly. Of course. And I'll get into that later. That's all about balancing life. Because CEOs also, tremendously low rate of relationship success. Tremendously low. Exactly. Well, they're still here. Well, that's good. I'm glad you're bucking the trend for now. Give another 2 years. But anyway, so you have absolutely no life. If you want it to work, you need to be married to your job. Everything else is second. It sucks. Like, well, you need balance. That's no way to live. Exactly. It's no way to live. But I have a feeling that most of you give up a lot to be successful. You watch all these motivational guys. Thing is, you look at them, like, I was listening to, I don't even know this man, but I venture to guess all these guys like, rah, rah, give it this, give it that. They usually don't have families. There's a reason for that. Because you dedicate yourself to your work. You can't be great at everything. Again, endless hours. Most companies, if you're lucky, you don't lose money the first 3 years. But I'm going to tell you guys, cool, making 10 grand a year. Yeah, most likely you're not going to have enough money to pay yourself, especially if you don't have investors. It sucks. I'm not going to punch out of that one. Gotcha. So there's another thing. If you have investors in the company, and let's say you're not turning the numbers they want, what happens? They're not going to be happy. Because to get those investors, you got to sell them on. So if you don't perform, that's not a good thing, man. That's not a good thing. Partners, are you in it alone? Do you have a partner? And I remember a few people have won. I would say a wise man once said, but I've heard this said many times. The only ship that doesn't sail is a partnership. I'm fortunate where I have a good partner, but let's say in the past, might not have had the greatest relationship. Not that they were bad people, but some people, just like relationships, y'all ever been with that person, like, you know, dating someone, this guy's perfect, and then you find out, like, he pees on the floor or something? Like, it's kind of like that, but on a macro scale, we're dealing with millions of dollars. So, it's crazy. As you can tell, I think in metaphors, so really weird metaphors. So here's this article, Startup Continued. Do you get a paycheck? If you don't have money to sustain yourself without pay, probably gonna have some problems at the beginning because you gotta live, right? So are you gonna live with your mom? Are you gonna bunk up with your bro? How long can you sustain that? Are you gonna eat? Personnel, okay? What happens if you do grow? But you're not quite profitable and you're still paying off old debt. How are you gonna afford to hire people? And generally speaking, if you have a bad month, you gotta pay them, right? They're not gonna be like, oh, cool. So who doesn't get the paycheck that month? You. It gets better. I'm just pointing out the bad sides. I just like to start with the bad. It's like good news or bad news. Whoever says good news first?
Nobody.
And you really work for yourself. That's the question I always ask people. This is actually a good thing. You know, that pay taxes. Obamacare raised our health care premiums by 48%. Our company lost 48%. We literally had an increase of 48, near 50%. Just because this law went down. not making a political statement. I don't need any like riots or anything. I know this is a university. But yeah, it happens. It's just, it's a definite liability in the company. Also, who do you really work for? If you're producing a product, a service, a good, say you're a plumbing company or you're selling a good, you're not working for yourself, you're working for your customers. So you're not really ever, there's no such thing as working for yourself. There really isn't. So you never have that autonomy. Holy crap, I'm gonna mess up. Okay, inventory tax. If you have an S corporation, which is what you start out on a lot of times, that's what most companies are registered as, there's C Corp, S Corp, that's another lecture. Hey, guess what? At the end of the year, if you have inventory in your company, spills over, you get personally taxed on it. You're always working for someone. Patent trolls, least legal costs. Remember Steve Adler, the Stone Ice Story, he did an article with Inc. And his article stated one thing, one of his points was like the four things I knew as a CEO, you know, as CEO when I started. One of them is legal. I think he said put 10 to 20% of your total earnings towards legal expenses. Because if you get big, or even if you're small, people are gonna sue you for shit you didn't even know was wrong and might not be wrong. They just might be trying to shake you down. We got sued for automated emails. Yeah. Yeah, you know how when someone places an order and 2 days later you go, hey, was that good? Did you like your shipment? Oh, no. One company claimed they owned the patent for that. Obviously, we countersued. It was washed. Still cost us $5,000. Think about it that way. $5,000 of money that could have gone towards R&D, bonuses, you name it. Those are called packages. Logistics of running a company. How are you shipping things? You know, are you a B2B company, B2C? So there's a lot of things to look at. Like, how are you going to get this product into people's hands? What is your start game and what is your end game? Are you starting B2B? Am I going to go with a distributor who's going to get into his store? Am I going to just go to his store directly and say, hey, bro, you want some protein? That's exactly the call we had the other day. Very successful closing right there. Just say, hey, bro, you want some protein? So nobody ever became great being some of the fish, except for Scotty. He was really great. yeah, I'm a Bulls fan. I'm sorry. Yeah, but at the end of the day, look at this, Bill Gates, Jobs, all those guys, they generally run their own thing. Like, those are the guys you look at, you're like, wow. You're not like, oh, you know, that guy's assistant, legendary. Generally speaking, it's like coming in second in the Super Bowl. Nobody's gonna remember you. Can anybody remember who lost 2 years ago? I'm sure someone can, that was rhetorical. So there's one thing. Risk sucks, reward can be greater. You start a business, do you guys want to be poor your whole life? Just make $50,000 a year? Not 50 grand, not poor by any means, but when you start a business, I think all of us want to do the right thing, want to do good by our customers, but you guys want some payout at the end, right? Right? Yeah? Mm-hmm. Okay, good. Gotta make sure everybody's awake. So you guys want some payout at the end, so obviously there's reward. Right? There's a reward to starting your own business, so that's one reason we do it. So here's the deal. You are the reason it succeeds or fails. Whether it's your idea, whether it's your execution on that idea, you can't blame someone else. Anybody here have ever competed in bodybuilding? Or fitness, physique, bikini? Okay, anybody here ever gymnastics or any individual sport? You guys are unathletic folks. Anybody here play team sports? Team sports, anybody? Okay, good! Okay, check it out. Now, in team sports, you can be the greatest quarterback in the world, but if the wide receiver doesn't catch the ball, it doesn't matter. You're still going to lose the game, right? Now, in bodybuilding, which I always found, other than taking away judging prejudice and all that, in bodybuilding, it's you. If you don't stick to your diet, if you don't train hard, you're going to lose. It's on you. Starting a business versus working for someone is the equivalent of bodybuilding versus baseball. You'd be the greatest shortstop in the world, but if your second baseman sucks, good luck turning a double play. Damn, my metaphors are on point today. All right. So here's the thing. It is the American way. Immigrants start a disproportionately large amount of companies in this country. Immigrants. My mom owned a cookie store. She immigrated here from Poland and Israel. So I'm first generation American right here. And I carry on that tradition of owning a business. Now, Americans who are indigenous, I'd like to say, not like Native American, who are from America, many, like say two, three generations, generally don't start businesses. I think when people come to America, we're still the land of opportunity, right? It's the land of opportunity. So immigrants come here and they're like, I'm gonna do some big shit here. And that's why they risk it all and they start that business. And there's something to be said about that. So, I mean, anybody here first generation American? Anybody here come here from another country? You want to start your own business?
Well, my father actually started his own business.
That's what's up. See? One out of, how about you?
Nah, I'm not a business major.
But do you, what do you want to do?
Just be a doctor.
Okay, cool. See, now that's kind of like about private practice or emergency room type stuff.
When I get there, I'll decide.
Okay, so you're going to be, that's actually quite a profession. You have a lot of schooling in it. That's why I never did it. That I don't like blending guys and shit. Like, what kind of doctor? Specialist?
I like everything. I
go for proctology.
What was that?
Proctology.
Nah.
I'm sure this is a man.
I'm sure.
Like, who wants to be an asshole doctor, right? Don't be a gynecologist. That would ruin you. Because you know the good ones never come in to get checked out. It's like you never get supermodels coming in. All right. So here's what I recommend before you start. Work for someone else, garner experience, learn from their mistakes, learn what's right and wrong. Okay, now, the best thing I ever did was work for Weider Publications because I got to see not only how my business operated, but as a salesperson, I got to go in and view other people's businesses and see what their benefits, negatives, pluses, minuses, whatever it is, what they did. And you know, you go in and you're like, if I own that company, man, I would have done this, it would have worked. You actually get to do that. So you can't do that without that perspective. So everybody here, when you graduate college, if you are in college, and also just came here because you know you thought it'd be cool. If you're in college right now, I recommend if you don't at least get an internship before starting something. I don't care if you get a million, I don't care if you get that Donald Trump $1 million loan or whatever the hell he got. At the end of the day, just work for someone else. You know what I mean? Just get that perspective, get that experience. That is a huge thing. You want that experience. That's why colleges are big on internships. At the end of the day, I hate to say this to you guys. My company does, I don't even know who has a degree in my company. For me, it's all about experience and attitude. And that's where it's going. Like, obviously, as a doctor, you need to know how to take out an appendix that you can't just fucking wing that. Right? Like, business, like, here's the funny thing about business, y'all. Oh, man, I got the southern. So here's the thing about business. Like, when I went to school, which is only 15 years ago, it's not that long ago, social media didn't exist. Think about it. Facebook, Instagram, YouTube. It wasn't there. It wasn't there. So everything I learned is indeed almost obsolete. It's pretty much obsolete. And there's certain tenets of marketing that really still play a role. Positioning, differentiation, obviously things that you live your life by. But like Facebook, you have to learn and adapt. So the degree you're working towards and you're probably going in debt up to your eyeballs in, it's gonna get you in that door for that initial interview. After that, no offense. Your degree means fuck all. Just being real. It's all about application. And if you start your own business, do you look at your own resume? No. It's all about application and doing things. So, you know, that's something to look at. I'm not saying don't get a degree and drop out of school now. Don't pull a Bill Gates. Although it worked for him. It probably won't work for you. Again, like I said earlier, become an expert in the industry. Because if you are an expert, again, with that 96% failure rate, if you are an expert, it gives you a much better chance of not failing. Again, if you've never practiced baseball in your life, you step on the field in the major leagues, you're probably going to be scared when the 97-mile-per-hour baseball comes by. So you gotta have that going on. You gotta know who the distributor is, what the distribution channels are, everything about what your competition is doing. Become an expert. Money. Can't just pull. I mean, there are ways. I mean, you've heard of people taking out $10,000 loans, but usually they have a day job when they do that. Very rarely, because you have to pay your bills, right? You still got bills to pay. So you have to obtain funding, which again, will probably mean giving up a portion of your business. Think Shark Tank. Save money. First companies I started were basically, you know, I had money from my previous careers and I was able to just say, F it, you know, I didn't have kids at the time. So I was able to afford to do that or have a plan. You know, what is your plan? The plan would be like if you have a current job, you're gonna moonlight, start this business on the side, dedicate 4 hours a day. And I've known many people who've done that. Usually it's with like coaching businesses and kind of like service-based industries, but I've known supplement companies do it. I've known good paper goods products. I mean, it can be done. There you go. Obviously, I'm prepared. So basically, yeah, exactly what I just said. And again, find investors or partners. There's nothing wrong with investors and partners. It's just not a thing. Partner, yeah, I have a good partner. But investors, you know, I have issues with a board telling me what decisions I can make. And one of the benefits to having a startup company is being able to pivot and outmaneuver your competition. When you have investors having to give you that okay all the time, it's really hard to take advantage of that advantage of that situation. Here we go again. So I was telling you about the two things that are pretty much immutable in marketing. So when you start a business, you want to think. Before I move on, any questions? That's not what you want to think. That was just me. Yes?
Yeah, you kind of touched a little bit. What's your overall view on college? Like, how valuable do you think our education is to us as opposed to dropping out and starting a business or something and trying to build your...
Are your parents paying for college?
Yeah.
Stay. Take advantage of that. Get the degree. You'll learn stuff. You'll have life experiences. I mean, college is almost a rite of passage in America, especially if you can afford it. You know, me, I couldn't afford it. So, in hindsight, I just wanted it. I mean, you know, being that my father finished school, he actually went to University of Miami, so kind of weird being at FSU today. I grew up to hate Florida State. Like, seriously, I remember cheering when y'all went wide right. Like, that's how bad it is. No, he's dead now. It doesn't matter. Or else he'd be calling me right now. You're like, what the fuck? And my mom didn't finish school. She was an immigrant, obviously. So, you know, I always thought it, my brother and I should finish college. That's the only reason I did. But it's always cool to say it. Like, when you fill out, like, you know, the surveys, like, you a college grad? Yeah. But other than that, it depends on your, obviously, a doctor. A doctor, a lawyer, things like that. But as far as business and marketing and stuff, a lot can be learned from internships and, you know, getting part-time jobs and just learning. The best advice I can give to people wanting to go into business is if you have time to get an extra job for extra money, become a server or become a retail clerk because you have to interact with people. Interacting with people is the number one thing you do in most careers. And also learning how to work with people. Like, to move up the corporate ladder, if you want to work for someone else or work within a corporation, you know, you got to be able to play the game. So to be able to get into that, you really have to. I really think that having that experience in retail or being a server especially, because people are just waiting to get pissed off so you can write some stuff off their check, you know? And having to work for tips, just the tip, that's really, you know, that's something that you learn. Because that's essentially what you do in a business. You're working for people's approval so they will buy your goods or your services. So, positioning. An effort to influence consumer perception of a brand or product relative to the perception of competing brands or products. Its objective is to occupy a clear, unique, and advantageous position in the consumer's mind. Basically, positioning is where people associate a company, whether it's luxury.
Yes.
Yes.
I was just going to ask if you think, how important do you think knowing your market is for positioning? I mean, is that a...
It's huge because you have to know what your competition's position is in order to position against it. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So if, for example, with Tiger Fitness, bodybuilding.com's position was over X million customer service. That's a big number. It's really hard to pay attention when you have that many people, right? So ours is, you're more than just a number. See where that kind of countered their position? I appreciate that question because that really helps to get that across.
Thank you.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, definitely. The bodybuilding background, tiger fitness example really says
it. Does that make sense for everybody else? Okay, cool. Cool, so yeah, it's basically positioning is positioning yourself against the market. Something that resonates in people's minds. So, yeah.
Gotcha.
Do I need to explain positioning any further? Does that kind of get it across for everybody? Cool, awesome. And then of course, it works. Differentiation. Result of efforts to make a product or brand stand out as a provider of unique value to customers in comparison with its competitors. Similar to positioning, you know you want to set your position as a way to differentiate yourself from your competitors. Any questions on differentiation or positioning, guys? Okay, cool.
Do you have any examples in your business?
Differentiation? I think that you're more than just a number. You work just well for that, too. Positioning differentiation can be mutually exclusive. They can also work together. Does that make sense to you? Awesome.
There's a question over there.
Yes, sir.
I think just from knowing about your company and everything, I think your main differentiator is how transparent you've been with your products and how most of the time companies don't give every ingredient in their products.
So yeah.
Maybe that could be a big...
You can have many points of differentiation, too.
Yeah,
you can have multiple points.
I think that's changing the industry in itself, becoming more transparent and open to everything.
I think that there were a few companies, us being, you know, actually my first company, Salvation, being one of the first, actually listing out what's in the product. Before, everything was a proprietary blend. There's a few reasons for that, which is kind of beyond the scope of this. But, you know, as far as, you know, that's MTS, and that's a great example. But with both companies, they're both autonomous, privately owned companies, separate entities. So that's where, yeah, they both have their own unique points of differentiation. But you're more than just a number here, I think, works for both because of our shared personalization and personalized customer service. Does that answer that? Cool. So, sir, here's the synopsis of that. Funding. How are you going to pay for this startup? How is it going to be funded? Is it itself? Is it investors? Are you going to do an IPO, which is a public offering? Snapchat's public offering, for example. That's beyond the scope, but I mean, you look at how they overvaluated it, now they have no voting shares, that's a mess. How are you gonna fund the company? Concept. What is your company's concept? What does your company stand for? What is its positioning? What is its differentiation? Business model. How's it gonna be set up? Are you gonna be working out of your house with another place handling logistics and phone orders and this and that? What is your business model? Distribution model, are you gonna go B2B, B2C? Business to consumer. Are you going to go distributors? Are you going to sell directly to stores? Got to figure that one out. If you're a service business, are you going to go to business? Let's say you're doing a cleaning service. Are you going to go to places like this? Are you going to go door to door? What's your model there? Keep your overhead low. Overhead will kill the company. I mean, that's one thing you want to look at. Inventory versus sales, return on sales. I mean, you can probably get into that as much as anybody. I mean, you have too much on the shelf and not enough moving out. I mean, that's you look at a store, you walk in, you're like, wow, look at all these products. I walk in and say, wow, look at all that money. Because that's just cash sitting on the shelf. So your goal is to turn that. What's your rate of turn? You know, we like to keep things within 90 days, 3 months. And it's hard to do that because you get slow movers. You'll bring in a new line, you're like, oh, look, what? This just isn't moving. 6 months, a year, expiration date comes on with consumable goods. Things to look at. Physically expand as little as possible. I mean this for businesses like myself or even retail stores. You might think, man, if we just had more space. My opinion has been until you have product falling out the door, keep your overhead, your rent, your utilities as low as possible because those are just margin eaters. Those just eat all your profits. They're profit eaters. And it might be cool to have that cool little office overlooking, you know, Fifth Avenue or whatever, but if it's not necessary, it's not necessary. And you might not need that Lamborghini till year 3. Marketing. How do you launch? Do you have a social media following? Social media is new. We were just talking about that. How are you going to launch? We're going to tell people about it. Trade magazines, trade shows, door-to-door. You know, you represent your company yourself. Generally speaking, if you look at there's a book out called Ready, Fire, Aim. It's a great book because he says the CEO, the founder of the company, his main job at the company should be sales. Because if you can't sell a product, what's the point of having plants in your office if you can't make a sale? Your number one goal should be to sell the goods. Again, do you need to run magazine ads? Trade shows, will that help you? And of course, back to distribution. How are you going to do that? Are you advertising to distributors and trade pubs so that they push it through? Or are you going to do a consumer pool strategy where you get consumers to go to stores and ask for something? So here's the sustaining part. Now what? Well, let's say you come out with one product. I have whey protein. Okay, cool. Other people can make whey protein. How do you keep it fresh? Research and development, innovation should be a part of what you do. And that costs money. And that takes money to, so I mean, if you're doing well on one thing, to grow that, you have to invest. So it's almost like every time you launch a new product, you're investing into a new company. Because think about it, that's newfound inventory that every time you bring in a line, you have, retail's the perfect example of every industry. Every time you bring in a line, it's pretty much starting a new business with that business relationship because you're ordering most likely separately if it's a direct brand. So it's a perfect analogy of what you need to do. So expansion and growth. Where are you going to expand into? International? Can you afford, let's say Costco wants your product. Can you afford to fill that PO, that purchase order? And what if it doesn't sell and they send it back? Which I'm sure you've seen that. You're done. You have how much muscle farm image? Okay, how about
zero?
But I mean, think about it. And usually expanding like that, what's it going to do? It's going to alienate your niche. Because, I mean, why would I sell a product that's in Costco if I'm a vertical store? Doesn't make sense. Again, storing and fulfillment, are you going to need a warehouse or are you going to just pay to have it stored off-site? Again, both have their advantages and disadvantages. Cash flow is key. A lot of companies operate where they lose money. I can only point, and this isn't pointing them out because they're private companies. But for example, Muscle Farm and Isatori are two companies that are publicly traded. Isatori did $10 million in sales 2 years ago and lost $4,000. That's not good. But they have investors. But if they were a privately held company, what happens when you don't have money in the bank? You either have to take out a line of credit or something like that. So you need to think about how are you going to maintain positive cash flow. You might have a lot of stocks. You got to have just-in-time inventory. Again, we talked about the three-month terms. Very pertinent, very important when you start a business is realizing that there's a delicate line. Why are you out of stock? I'm like, I can't just like say, hey, here's a new product. Put 20,000 units on the floor and risk only selling 1,000. So you almost have to skate that fine line. And just-in-time inventory isn't always just-in-time. KPIs. Those are something we instituted. Those are really cool, where it sets measurable numerical objectives to for every department. For example, customer service, we want to have all calls answered within 10 minutes at 90%, or whatever the matrix may be. But KPIs make it where you can set objectives and goals for each department within your company. Profit versus sales. I can sell a lot of products by discounting, do BOGOs. That doesn't really matter. What matters at the end of the day is your bottom line. So if you can have, again, look at Muscle Farm. It took them $20 to make one at one point in their company. I'm not picking on them. It's just we have very few private companies in my industry. So think about it. Like, that's not good. So you got to look at what your profit is at the end of the day, your EBITDA. Your earnings, I think that's later on. Earnings before taxes, interest, amortization, and depreciation. Okay. Yeah, there it is. I knew I wrote it down. So building the brand. Again, growth requires money. Do you need a credit line? I always keep a credit line. You try not to use it ever, but you always got to make sure just in case. Let's say I get a big order from Australia or something. You need to have that just in case you need to tap into it. A lot of companies live on credit. Again, there's so many ways to do things. You can live life in debt. It has tax advantages. At the end of the year, you want to show you made as little money as possible. Uncle Sam taxes you and penalizes you for being profitable. It is what it is. I mean, that's why, I mean, you know, small businesses, I mean, you look at the taxation, a lot of them are taxed at around 50%. Unless you're a large corporation, you lobby and then you do away with paying no taxes. So the goal is to get the size of like Enron, and then you're good to go. And again, more money, more profits. When you're dealing with $1 million in sales, you make a mistake, okay, a couple grand. You're dealing with $100 million in sales, you're making a mistake, it's a few million dollars in mistakes. So you gotta be careful, more money, more problems. Evolution of technology, will you be able to adapt? A lot of companies are still in the mainstream. My brother does this, he's in digital marketing. They're still trying to keep to catch on to Facebook. Like every high school kid in America can build a killer Facebook page. These companies are paying 50, 60 G's to build a Facebook page. I'm like, my nephew can do it for like 20. You know, it's like, it's crazy, but you get these archaic companies and they're still like, you know, what do we do with social media? And you're a freaking Fortune 500 company. So that's the thing, you need to evolve with technology. That's where I think a lot of you younger generation will have your advantage. Is that like, for example, my kids can do more on an iPad than I can. My daughter can use my computer better than I can. And I'm an educated man, you know? So what's their norm, I had to learn, you know, as I went on. But that's their life, you know? Again, you know, I didn't have social media when I was in college. Marketing position, what is your position? We already went over that. Product evolution, for example, every year they come out with a new model of cars, right? If you look at the Ford Explorer in 1996 versus now, it's a different car. So you gotta kind of move on and evolve with the times. So building the brand and sustaining it, are you gonna be private or public? Well, that stuff. Exit strategy is something you should always have within the company. This goes to sustaining. If you get that offer for $100 million, you can take it. And I know you might not, but you have to set that number when you're setting up a business, when you're going over your goals. That's something your CPA, if you have a good CPA, will want to know. Just because, for example, how you set up your company, C-Corp versus S-Corp. A C-Corp is better in the short term for taxation. An S-Corp is easier to sell. So those are things you need to look at. And it takes if you don't want to sell within 7 years of your sale, if you have a C-Corp, you want to convert to an S-Corp. So if you're not sure you want your business for the next 15, 20 years, maybe that's not the way you want to go. Sales channel evolution, maybe you start as a direct company and then you're like, you know what, exhausted this, we have enough consumer demand, it's time to call him up and have him carry it in the store. Maybe your company evolves that way. You start out as a direct business model and you move over. Staffing for growth, another thing. Look at the government involvement in that. Not that, again, I'm not making political statements. But if you have a certain number of employees, you have to pay different taxes. You have to have different, for example, I think, what was the new law they just proposed that if you have over 100 employees, you have to provide, this seems very funny, but it just, bear with me, you have to provide sanitary napkins for your female employees. Matt, whatever. You know, talking about stuff. But think about it, like if you're a large company with many locations, that's a huge expense that you didn't have before. And that's actually been proposed, I believe, last week in the House. So employee morale and retention, how do you keep your employees happy? It's very hard to replace an employee. All right, so social media, open discussion. What do you guys think, and you know, you can raise your hand and interject. Social media, in general, and how it impacts business.
I think it's the best thing to do.
You think for every bit, for even B2B, I think it would help.
I think everybody in the older generation felt like everybody playing on the phone was anti-social.
Yeah.
And now it's made us feel a little more actually more social.
Yeah, you?
It helps to have a direct connection. Another way to market yourself or set an image.
It absolutely helps you connect with the customer, good or bad. Hell, look at, again, look at the use of social media in politics, in media, in the election. Look at how Hillary positioned herself versus Trump. Look at how Rand Paul positioned himself. I don't think anybody here is going to deny the importance of Twitter, Facebook, and social media in the results of this past election. Good or bad, it played a huge role. It's a way to reach a lot of people from your phone. You know, it's a way to reach a lot of people. Anybody else? Social media, good and bad. What's the bad? So positioning.
But I didn't grow up with social media all the time.
Yeah, positioning. Any other downsides?
There's a million people just like.
Yeah, good.
And negative publicity from it.
Negative publicity. Used to be an old mantra. Any PR is good PR. I don't know if that's true. You look at just this week, Under Armour. He said something nice about Trump and Nordstrom. They actually cut off Ivanka's. That perfume line, now it's the number one seller on Amazon, good and bad. Your decisions on so with that can, I mean, you could call it social media. It was really hard to say don't buy a product before. Now you just post it on your Facebook page. There you go. So, my thoughts on social media. It's great if you use credit. And that's it. Let's say, if you're selling goats, or if you're selling those survival kits, like food that doesn't go bad, probably good to align yourself with a conservative position, okay? Or something like that. That's just an example. It can be dangerous, and I already made that sentiment thanks to what he brought up, is that, you know what? Usually an opinion, there's 50% who like it, 50% who don't. So there's something to look at. There's something to look at. So it's good and bad. Social media can be the greatest thing ever. It can also be the worst thing. This is the last part, balancing life. Has anybody read Relentless, From Good to Great to Unstoppable by Grover, Michael Jordan, Kobe Bryant, trainer, Dwayne Wade, anybody? Great book, I recommend you read it. Basically, those people are called cleaners. Most CEOs are cleaners. Cleaners are people who excel really great at one thing. They usually suck at everything else. I mean, Kobe Bryant, other than LeBron James, I think every professional athlete at that level has had relationship scandals or issues or things like that. So it's very tough. What I recommend, married, go to counseling once a month at least. Even if you think things are perfect, that's what I recommend. We have time in your family to spend it because it will be limited. You guys have kids?
No, we're both personal trainers and starting a business, so we see each other here for about an hour.
That's enough to program.
I just did hear your instructor. Okay.
So I mean, but when you have time, put down the phone, have that dinner out, you know, be with each other. This is more the balance of life part. Could be right, could be wrong. From my experience, which I'm still learning. Cut out wasteful activities that have no ROI. Business has ROI, training obviously has ROI. You can buy, you should always have that time. I'm not saying go squat 1,000 pounds. I'm saying go for a jog, do some yoga. That'll help you perform better in all areas of life. But cut out wasteful activities. I know everybody likes their PlayStation, but as college students who might have extra time, if you start a business, you're not going to have that extra time that you had before. And whatever you're doing at the moment, go 120. 120, Eric Thomas' line, basically 100% is perceived. Like, what is your max allowed? We don't know what our max allowed is, because I don't think any of us have ever really gone there. You know, I don't think we've ever truly tapped into that maximal effort. You know, that Michael Jordan with the flu in Game 5. You know, I don't think many of us have tapped into that. So 120 means what you thought was your hardest, go harder. So if you're spending time with your kids, saying that if you have kids, when you do have kids, hopefully this resonates, like, put your phone down. Put your phone down, spend time with them. When my dad worked, he'd get home from work at 5, he didn't have a cell phone. He spent quality time, and I don't think that a lot of, I go to soccer games, and I'm sitting there watching my daughter play, and these dads are texting. I'm like, my daughter's kicking your daughter's ass. I'm like, you gotta watch this. So whatever you're doing, whether it's business, personal, whatever you're doing, go 120%. So the startup recap, different. This is basically bringing it all together, open Q&A. It's a perfect time. About now, I'm going to move on. Differentiate, find a position. You need money. Experience before risk, most of the time. Some people you can start a business and roll with. Some people, me, get that experience. Work for someone else. Your life as you know it is over. Or like 94% of your peers, you will fail. If you're gonna go in, don't you put your toe in the water, do a cannonball, and jump in that water. There's no putting your toe in. So, sustaining a startup recap. Growing pains, personnel, growth, cash for growth, evolution of the company, technologies, innovation, coming out with new fresh stuff. Balance, you'll never achieve balance. You can try your best, you can come close to it, but you'll never be perfect. You can always strive to be better. Do your best to go 120 in everything you are doing at that given moment. Notice I haven't checked my texts once during this presentation. Give me this my 120. And of course, cut out stuff with limited ROI. I know it sucks, but some things you might love to do, you know, if something has to go, it's either that time with your kids, and your wife, girlfriend, whatever, or playing video games, or watching Sunday. I haven't watched a full Sunday football game. I didn't even watch the whole Super Bowl. So, I'm sorry about that. But he thought it was funny, that's why I left it in there. I put it in as a joke. But anyway, question LP Q&A about anything in business, personal training, diet. Again, that was written before this issue. So anyway. So anyway. Okay, there we go. So we'll just go to that. So this is where it's fun. This is all about you, whether it's about training, since this is a TAMID group, I wanted to address, you know, their whole thing with startup. We thought that'd be the best thing to go with, because a lot of people here probably want to start their own business, or at least later on down the road. If I mean private practice, you know, that's where the point's at. But, you know, anything, or maybe you don't right now, and you will later, and maybe you're feeling like, hey, that idiot Lobliner said some stuff, and maybe I should. Maybe at one point you take home, maybe if it's, hey, you know, getting married, maybe we should just once a month go see a counselor. You know, things like that, like, you never know. Like, I'll think back to things I've listened to and just have that take home. So open Q&A, yeah.
It's not even a question, but I'll just start with this. Unfortunately, me and her have to go because it's calls, but I really appreciate it.
No, thank you so much for coming out,
Brent. Seriously.
Much appreciated. He's up the road, Clean Nutrition.
Come on, slide in. Follow me on Instagram, Dylan Quick Fitness.
I actually do follow you. Yes, sir.
When you're, let's say, 1, 2, or 3 years into your business and it's still not successful, how do you identify what you should?
As far as selling your business or if it's failing?
If it keeps failing and you're 3 years in, 4 years in, it's not working, how do you know when you should as well?
Sometimes you just gotta stop the bleeding. You know, you just gotta stop the bleeding. If it's completely, if there's no sign of any return, there's no uptick. And then it's even hard to say then, because there's another book by Malcolm Gladwell called The Tipping Point. Has anybody read that? It used to be college reading. What's wrong with my books? Anyway, so Tipping Point, basically, you know, there's companies that kind of fumble along for 3-4 years and all of a sudden they tip. And all of a sudden they're a $20 million company. It can happen. Usually it doesn't. If you're not getting traction within 3 to 4 years, I'd probably look into other options. You'll probably be broke as hell then anyway. Most likely you'll be broke as hell. Yes?
So with like people becoming, you know, CEOs and achieving the American dream and all that, there's a lot of talk about like vision. So when you were working at Joe Weider and kind of starting out, did you envision the life you have now, or did you just put your head down and work hard and look up and realize you accomplished all this?
Okay, the question is, for those of you on this side, when I started at Weider, and I think I'd be more mad. No, I loved corporate America. I really liked it. I liked the whole meeting thing. I liked wearing a suit. I could fit in a suit back then. It was awesome. I liked it. I really did like it. And, you know, it was just, it's one of those things where I was good at what I did. I enjoyed it. And I did not foresee any of this. And it just kind of happened by hook or by crook. As soon as I felt like it was time to move on from Weider, I started that company with Sylvester Stallone. And that failed. I mean, they ended up going bankrupt. But before that, they fired me before that. They obviously didn't think I was worthwhile. So, but I'm still in business, they're not. So, nonetheless, I think that it just kind of went that way, and I always thought that for me, being able to make my own decisions and control my own destiny was the best thing. So that's kind of where it ended up. But it was just a gradual progression. You know, because after Instone, I'm like, you know, I can't give up now. That's what I'm like. I'm just going to start. It's one of those, like, does anybody ever seen Lobliner? I'm getting old. Anyway, like, okay, any of you, but like Mike Katz, when he's like, yeah, you know, so they used to call me, you know, Jew boy, you have rusty fenders and everybody's, he's like, I'll show them. Then he ran around the track and he became a pro bodybuilder, and that's the story. Yeah, you remember that, right? You gotta remember Mike Katz part. That's a Jewish moment for us, man. But it's like, yeah, Mike Katz. You know, he ended up being a big, made huge money off of Planet Fitness. But I digress. But anyway, I think it was kind of like that. It's like, I'll show them. You know, I'll definitely show them. So you can just close it. It's all good. We'll go blue screen for now. So for me, it was just unfinished business. So I think it just progressed. And through your life, I don't think we try to make as good of plans as possible, but plans are fluid and they change. So no, I wouldn't guess that I'd be doing what I'm doing now. And I like always tell people, like, I regret every day starting my own business. Because honestly, I kind of envy the people who have the 9-to-5s. Their schedule's in stone. They get their paycheck, they have their health care, and they know what's gonna happen. And they're very consistent with life. They know that they go to the gym at 7 a.m., they roll into work, they go home, they go to their kids' soccer practice. They don't have to worry about having to go to Australia to broker a deal. You know what I mean? So there is something to be said about working. There is advantages to working for someone else. Definite advantages. And like my brother's done really well. I'll get you to your next. My brother has done phenomenal. Phenomenal. Probably financially phenomenal. Everything's great. And he works for someone else. He travels here and there, but he gets, oh, PTO, time off? Nah, that ain't happening. You're always working. You're always working. Like, he can literally go on vacation. Like, actually go on vacation. Something he said about it. Something he said. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was going to ask, how do you get your foot in the door in a company? Like, if you're, you know, you don't have a degree. What if you don't have a degree? You want to get your foot in the door to say, like, something like you do, like fitness or, you know, supplements and health. You know, how would you get in the door? Would you call, like, companies and...
For our company,
yeah.
Eric, I try, obviously there's certain positions like CFO, editor, mm-hmm. You can't take somebody from shipping, slot them in there. Yeah. For our company, and I speak for us, then I'll speak general, everybody, I like everybody starting shipping or in customer service, because mm-hmm. I want you to know every part of the company. You know, just like I watched the show Undercover Boss, I almost get offended. I'm like, how do you not know that part of your company? Like, you know, for example, on Black Friday, I was able to go to our Vegas warehouse because instead of hiring a temp, which by the time you train them, you let them go. I mean, that's a huge, you know, I'm able to go there and ship all weekend and step into that that position within the company. You know, that's not quite, most CEOs aren't going to be caught dead shipping, right? So we're able to do that. I think that if you're starting, just be willing to start low. As far as the fitness industry, it's a small industry in diapers. There's not much pay. There's very few companies that can afford to pay over $50,000 a year because they just don't make the money. So I look into bigger industries. I would, and I'm not convincing people not to follow their dream in fitness, but just like the outlay of the companies, you look at a large company in our industry is $250 million, whereas a large company in another industry is $250 billion. So it's just a smaller industry and it's harder to make normal money. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Because it's a niche vertical. It's a niche vertical. Yes, sir.
How do you stay so motivated all the time? Like, you drove 4 hours and had some dinner, finished up at like 10:30. As soon as we were done with dinner, you were literally like on cardio, just like posting on social media, talking about how you're gonna answer emails for like 3 hours after that, waking up and just doing all 3 minutes today. Like, you're literally like a machine.
You know, a lot of what we have right now is influenced by our past. You know, I was in a situation where my family had, and this could be part of it, where we had stuff, and then my mom was an addict, so we lost it. So, and I grew up in the inner city, so it was one of those things where I'm constantly fearful of losing everything, but I also just love what I do. And I'm also OCD with needing to answer people. And also a lot of things just need to be done. Like, there were a few emails that, actions that needed to be taken today needed my approval on last night. So I wanted to make sure that was in everybody's email box. But generally speaking, I try to get back to old customer stuff within 24 hours. And if I let it go much longer, I'm just gonna have too much stuff to catch up on. Like, I can't take a full day off. I couldn't do it. It would just, because then I'd come back to like if we go to Australia, the difference is like their night is our day. So when we wake up at 6 a.m., it's your 6 p.m. So like imagine like you open your email box, you're like, oh. Like the whole day, it's all these emails line up. But it's just, I'm just honestly like, I'm motivated more by success than financial. And just following through, and I don't like letting people down. So I think it's a fear, but I've gotten better. I'm actually getting enough sleep now. I've driven myself to the emergency room twice from exhaustion. So I've learned my lesson, but I'm a lot better. It's a great lesson. Yes, sir?
Like, how do you fit keep fitness in your life while running a company and being so busy?
Well, I mean, I only train 4 days a week with weights. Other than that, I mean, I think everybody here can dedicate an hour to fitness. And that's just a matter of making wise food choices. I mean, it's really not that difficult. It's much harder to be unhealthy, in my opinion. Like, imagine how poor you'd feel in the morning if you couldn't move. If your body ached, if you were out of shape, if you had a cardiovascular endurance. Like, imagine how much that would suck. Like, we're mad because our quads are sore, our knees a little achy. Imagine if you were sedentary. That's got to be horrible. And also just, you know, when you go out to eat, just know that, you know, you don't have to get dessert every time. You can treat yourself here and there, but it's all about balance. Again, that goes into balance. Like, don't be one of those guys who won't eat cake at your girlfriend's birthday. Because that's just a dick move. Just eat the cake, you know? And it's one of those things. Like, you got to have that balance. Even if you don't like cake, just pretend you like it. Just, unless you're like 2 weeks out from a show, but like only one person in Europe competed before, so I'll take that as an issue. Yes, sir?
On average, how many hours a week did you work when you, before you were successful at your first energy company?
At Leader, I would get there at 7 a.m. and I'd leave at about 9 or 10 p.m. And that was making, when I started there, I was making $24,000 in California. And I'm not that old, we're 24,000. 24,000 was never a lot in California. In like 1930, that was 24 grand. You know? California's always been inflated, hyperinflated. Yes, sir?
My question is, what is your opinion on Amazon and what they've been doing with drones recently? Because you said that your business model focuses on the customer and paying attention to the customer. That kind of takes away the whole feeling that you have when you interact with someone.
You know, Amazon, I did a video on this, not on my main channel, but on Amazon, it's completely going to destroy the American economy. In a way. Because what happens is, we're all going to buy from Amazon because it's easy, it's cheap, right? What that's going to do is it's going to put under your mom and pops, you know, your mom and pop businesses. Is that still working, Shane?
It just went out, but I'll restart it.
Okay, you know how? Just kidding. So it's gonna definitely affect the mom and pop businesses. So what happens is they're literally funding the people who are putting them out of business, like your clerk at Ace Hardware or any of those stores, or nutrition store. You know, so it's gonna do that. And then what Amazon is gonna do, instead of hiring more people to compensate for people who lose their jobs in the private sector, so to speak, what Amazon, they're automating everything. They just came out with a grocery store that only needs 2 people to run it. Okay, just think about that. Amazon is amazing, but the ramifications for the U.S. economy could be absurd. Absurd. That's my feeling, and so far, it's kind of, I think it's definitely playing out a little bit. So, but Amazon for us, what we need to look at is how to get things to people in under 2 days and for free shipping. So we have free shipping over $99 and we have the personalized service like Amazon. You can email, you can contact our customer service, live chat at any time. We have 2 locations. We ship within 2 days in the US. So we needed to reach that. We need to reach free shipping at least some price level. You know, long-term look into free shipping for every order. So, you know, those are things you have to look into, but Amazon's not going to provide you, like, if you go in, when he was here, if you go into his store, he can offer you that advice, that interpersonal contact. What we offer you at Tiger Fitness is we can say, okay, at any time you can email me, get in touch with Sally or Tina or Austin, and they'll help you out with whatever problem you need. We have so many ways to get a hold of us, via the Turn 2 app, where it's a message system, via the live chat, via email, via phone. So we have like 6 or 7 methods to get a hold of us. And that's how we differentiate, is personalized service. So Amazon's always going to be a beast, but another way is, well, create brands for Amazon. Like I said, there's a few businesses out there, like, who's to say I don't want a few Amazon brands? Maybe in different industries. Like, you know, the problem is bodybuilding.com was down, reportedly, over 30% last year. And I think one of the reasons is they tried to go head-to-head with Amazon. It's not about fighting your brand. It's about working with them or using them to your advantage. And I think there are ways to work with them without hurting your core competency, your core brand. So again, that goes back to adaptation, to evolving. Nobody's going to beat Amazon in any industry. Nobody is. The government blocked a merger with Staples and Office Depot. Even though Amazon sells more office goods than both of them combined. Explain that. So anti-trade actually worked against the actual retailers, just trying to, they were probably doing that to compete with Amazon. Does that answer that? Awesome. Sir?
So as far as marketing budget goes, how do you decide how much money you're gonna put into each area of marketing, and how might you differently allocate those assets for a startup as opposed to a successful business like you have?
See, the thing is, I'm the worst one to ask about that because I've never had funding. Like, if you have to put together a business plan with funding, now we are now at a point where I think under 20 million, my goal is as little as possible. You know, you could allocate a certain amount in sampling. Maybe it's 20% of your return on sale, whatever that might be. But honestly, my goal is to do as much work as possible to eliminate as much cost as possible. And I think that's one reason why my startups have been successful, because I'm not afraid to get on the streets. I'm not afraid to get dirty. I'm not afraid to ship product myself. And I think that's what a lot of CEOs lack, is they lack the drive. Back in the day, when shit got tough, you got on the streets, you sold door to door. And I think a lot of business entrepreneurs lack that. And that's why the failure rate is so high. It takes a lot of work. You have to get dirty. A lot of people just don't want to get dirty. Does that answer?
Yeah.
Anybody on this? Yes, sir?
Can you talk about your products? Like, for example, you said before, like what made you go into a really competitive business? There's a lot of companies that sell supplements. What makes your products? And you were talking about research, for example, before. Like,
well, it comes down to using patented ingredients with us. We listed out what's on the labels. And now when we launched, you know, I had a non-compete which said I can only have a house brand, which means it's only sold at one location. Does that anything with ownership? So I launched MTS, and the one thing was at that time amino spiking was prevalent in the industry. So what I did is I created a protein that had label claim. And what we did, really, honestly, even with the first product I came out with was branch chains and drink, the minute it takes to, like, branch chain amino acids have been around in pill form since 1970s. But who wants to take a handful of horse pills during the training session? So the most often time it takes, we felt, was intra-workout. So we were able to put it into a powder form, and it was bitter and nasty, but we were able to spend the time in flavor. And we did it with our protein, made a transparent protein. Our goal was, at that time, Synthesix, and oh man, if that protein tastes like Synthesix, Synthesix is only 30% protein. So I'm like, wait a second, if we get it above 70, we can make it taste the same. And we can actually meet label claims. A lot of people get popped for not even amino spiking. Back then, they were just putting dextrose in it, you know? Like, back then, they were worse than they are now, and they were cheating people. So we made sure to, you know, get the amino panels tested and put that out there. So we differentiated with quality, and honestly, once we came out with the cookies and cream, it was game over in the flavor market. So between quality and flavor, that was a differentiation. Because combined, you talk about a competitive market, whey protein, cost of entry is high, and the competitive set is high. So we had two strong differentiating points, and we had strong messages. We were able to deliver them. As for everything else, you know, our goal is as much science, and you know, we present claims that are readily available to FTC compliant, like a 20% increase in testosterone. I'm not going to say that unless there's data. And so that's how we differentiate, no proprietary blends, things like that.
Did you go into the lab to do it, or you went to a college?
Honestly, flavoring, you could go to, I'm taking courses on it.
And the trials, like for the 20% testosterone increase.
Well, I mean, that's done by universities, usually by patent holders. But we do have a study, I mean, we did a study on branch chains back in 2009 that never got published because I left before we could actually follow through. I'm coming back to today because it was a well-performed study. It was done through the Meter Research Group alongside the College of Charleston. So the College of Charleston, Dr. Timothy, still, but yeah, it was a good study. It was a collaborative study, which means that it's really hard to doctor results with a collaborative study. So I wanted, like, because everybody's just saying, well, you funded it. I'm like, there's two dudes. You know, I was trying to engage everybody to be able to talk shit about it. Now everybody says, well, it wasn't published. I'm like, ah, that was one of those things, like, when you leave a company or when you sell a company, some things just get left floating, and that kind of sucks. So, it is what it is, but, yeah, we currently are looking at doing some studies on some of the current products. But the thing is, if you go with patented ingredients, like, you don't need to study creatine. Like, we all know creatine has all this data. So as long as you're using the patented form, you combine it with other patented ingredients, I think you're in a good spot to not, you know, sue. That's not the FTC or FDA come down. So that's, I mean, it's experience. There's no degree in formulating something like this. You just have to know how to read things, what works well, what pathways work. And just like any market, you have to differentiate the interview. And obviously, there's people like consultants. I mean, I'm not the end all. I know stuff, but there's other people out there smarter than me. And I consult them. Anybody else?
So, do you think yoga would be considered a substitute to cardio?
What?
Yoga a substitute to cardio.
Yoga?
A substitute cardio.
No, because you're not really burning calories. It's good, I mean, it's relaxing, it's cool, it's hip, but cardio is about burning calories and eliciting some sort of a VO2, and I don't think you're really doing that with yoga. But it's cool, I mean, it's healthy. It gets you moving, and I don't do yoga. But yeah, I'm not against yoga. Yes, sir?
How are you able to keep such a clean diet and, like, not cheat and not have cheat meals for 20 years? Like, how
my bad. Sure.
Well, okay, but for the most part, you told me that you've kept 99% on your diet for 20 years. That's not just a diet anymore. You're just the way you eat.
It's a lifestyle. That's like asking a vegan, how do you not eat steak?
Yeah.
So, you know, I think you know, the thing is, people always look at bodybuilders, like, or people who eat clean, like, oh my god, I can't believe you eat clean. But, like, I never go up to a vegan and go, oh, I know how you don't eat a hamburger. You know, it's just the choices you make. For them, it's more of an ethical reason. For me, I just know my body doesn't function as well. And going back to not sleeping and being able to operate on, you know, limited resources, I think my diet and health plays a lot. You know, people, you know, every time I post a video of the supplements, I take, oh my god, there's so many supplements. And then the next breath is like, how do you have so much energy? I'm like, yeah, I've been doing this for a while. I mean, for me, it's what works. And I'm not saying that everybody needs to spend what it would cost to take the supplements I take. But if you look at, like, Harrison on the Steelers, like, that dude spends, what is it, like, $4,000 a day on recovery? Like, between the cupping and the acupuncture and all that. Like, there's a reason he's still banging at 40 years old, like, near 40 years old, you know? It's what works for him. It's recovery techniques, and for me, it's nutrition. And, you know, I do a lot of recovery techniques. You know, I only weight train 4 days a week. The other 3 days, I'm recovering. You know, that's what you got to look at. I think it's just your overall balance. A lot of people just look at how do I make gains, how do I do this, how do I run faster. But I think if everything plays a role in it, you're going to be more apt to be better at what your chosen thing is. That's why, you know, with Exos, talk about, like, Exos is a system. From nutrition to recovery to performance. Yes, sir?
So, you're obviously extremely successful and you built a great life and all that, so...
Relatively.
So, do you ever foresee yourself retiring or are you just going to work until you can't physically work anymore?
There was a TEDx talks with this, I think it was titled like, Why 80-Year-Old Should Bodybuild or something like that. Was this old dude who went over like statistics of Alzheimer's going up when you retire. And, I mean, basically my thing is I can't imagine waking up every morning without an objective. And I see retirement as just waiting to die. And I just couldn't do it. I couldn't. I'd have to do something, whether it's volunteering or something. I always have to be active. I see myself working pretty much from my deathbed. Because I'd be bored. Like, I need that stimulation. I think everybody does. You know, the brain, if you've ever met a 70-year-old who's still in the workforce versus a 70-year-old who's retired. Dude, both the presidential candidates were 70 this year. Like, Clinton was like 68, Trump's like 70. Like, I don't see myself doing that shit at 70. Like, you imagine, like, your grandma running the country? That's pretty much what we got going on right now. Everybody's mad at, like, the two candidates. I'm like, why are they mad that they're, like, really old? I'm just playing. That's no knock to old people, obviously. But yeah, have you thought about it? Like, no one brought that up. It's like they did with Hillary something. Like, dude, Trump's like 80 years old. I'm like, dude, it's old. But yeah, it's like you see, you never really look. Well, you see, it's okay, this, that, you got the makeup and stuff. And then you look at him like, dude, that mofo is old. That guy's running the world. Like, you know, I remember when my grandfather was alive. He was an honorary old man. I can't imagine him with a red button next to him. You know, I'm like, okay, Grandpa. Yeah, but I don't see myself ever retiring, nor do I plan on running for president in 70. Any further questions? Anything?
Yo.
Yes?
Can you show us the world's greatest stretch?
Oh, world's greatest stretch?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Lucky I want to stretch pants. Okay, so the world's greatest stretch, it's not invented by Exos by any means, but it basically, so it stretches all parts of your body, so the key is being linear. So you take two hands, you lunge out in front, all right? So you want a straight line going here, hands on the inside, lunge forward, straight it back as possible, which I can't do. Feel the stretch in here, here, and then you take this arm, straight line up, then you take this arm, go to the outside of your leg, come up, lift up your toe, come back, posture hold, then step back or step forward.
Do you have a video on that?
Yeah, it's on my YouTube channel. You know I gotta figure that out now, right? That's the world's greatest stretch. Yes, sir.
How much cardio do you do at that point in the day?
I wasn't doing much, but I started doing about 20 minutes, 1 to 2 times a day, because I'm only training 4 days a week. It's because it helps me think. Yes, sir.
Trying to defy the odds and be like a 5-foot Jewish kid who can dunk. Like, what's
there?
I'm close. I can grab him right now.
Talk to that rabbi, maybe he can pray for you.
I'm talking about it.
Honestly, explosive movement, squats, snatches. Box squats, not really. I mean, you're stuck. I would want to see you free basing. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want you to stop. I want you, but, you know, if you want to do anything, do a pause squat. Box squats are very, they're, you know, you're stopping in the middle. It's great for powerlifting. I don't see much application for it in bodybuilding or strength in general. I want you to move free, because when you're slam dunking a basketball, you don't have a box under your ass. Like, I want to replicate it. And also plyos, man. Like, simple plyos just for movement, like, you know, in Exos, we do things, like, obviously you do the high plyo jumps, but, like, simple things, like, you set up cones, you know, you try to keep your balance, go this way, switch legs. I mean, those are things that I think are very tech, because you're working on each leg individually, working on your lateral movements. It also helps with injury prevention and lower back pain. So, yes, sir?
How do you address weak body parts? Like, is there a specific protocol you have?
I used to have a different answer, but I'm going to remember my man Doug Miller, and I got to give credit where credit's due. Train every body part as a weak point. Because for years I was training my arms are weak. I get it. You know, the internet thinks I don't have a fucking mirror. I know my weak points are, you know what I mean? Like, so, you know, for arms I was training them twice a week. I noticed my best growth when I train them like everything else. Train every body part like a weak body part, and God will take care of the rest. Because your genetic predispositions, if you train everything like a weak point, probably gonna make some gains. Again, that's Doug Miller, and I just stole it from him. But if I say I stole it from him, it's not really stealing, it's just helping spread his message of gains. Next question, is Doug Miller natural? Yes, sir. It depends. My answer is always like, when can you work out, and when do you like to work out? Like, well, I can train. When should I train? I'm like, when do you like to go? When can you work out? Either morning or night. Which do you like better? Night. Now, there's a thing. There's a study showing that morning trainers are more consistent with their training. There's a few studies. Because think about it. If you don't have life to get in your way, you're going to train first thing. It's your priority. But, excuse me. But, you know, if you can find the time in the evening, you can be consistent with it. Rock it out.
Or not just, you're just like random. Just keep it day, but random.
Train. Whatever, I mean, I can train when I'm at HQ, I train in the evening. When I'm at home, I train at 10 a.m. or 9 a.m. It just depends what works best for your schedule and your preferences. Really doesn't matter. Just consistency. Because your life isn't always going to be a 5 a.m. or a 5 p.m. life. It'll change. Back, right there.
Are you ever really ready to
you know, if you want to start your own business, do you need to be ready? Or like, if you're ready to do A, should you be aiming higher and try to?
Can you restate that?
Okay. Here, can let me think it over.
Okay, you got it. Yes, sir.
Question about like dieting or following meal plan. Do you think it's necessary to like have like frequent meals like 2.5-3 hours apart, or do you think it just is a total like calorie then, you know?
Oh, the question is, does meal frequency or timing matter? Yes and no. There's data showing that intermittent fasting is very beneficial for health, resting blood glucose, and all that good stuff. The question is, what fits your lifestyle better? If you have a job like me, I can't eat every 3 hours. I'll get caught in a meeting. I eat maybe 3-4 times a day. You know, and I used to be able to eat 6 times a day, honestly. At the end of the day, the main determinant on your gains or your losses of fat are gonna be, at the end of the day, what are your protein, carbs, fat? What are your macros at the end of the day? If they equal, if it's 300, 200, and 100 protein, carbs, fat, whether you eat that in 3 meals, 1 meal, or 6 meals, the main issue, and obviously there is there's slight differences, but the main determinant, I think 80 to 90% of it is what that is. If they're the same. If all same at the end of the day, I think that you're gonna have very similar results. Some argue that intermittent fasting is better. I think that it's easier to hit certain macronutrient goals unless you're a complete binger. I've known people put down 10,000 calories if you get them hungry. And it just depends on you. Like me, I couldn't do intermittent fasting because I like eggs for breakfast. You know, it's like, it's just not my lifestyle. I love the health data. And then you have the other thing, is, you know, there's certain studies on ketosis with similar calories being better. In my opinion, again, I don't think ketosis is necessary. It just depends, but as far as meal timing goes, I don't think it really matters. I think whatever works better, if you feel best eating every 4 hours, you feel best eating every 2. Just make sure you divide those up so at the end of the day your macros are similar. And that's 90. Once you hit that, then you can worry about the semantics. But until you have it where you meet your goal macros, you're not seeing the forest through the trees. That's the main objective. Can you adhere to that? Does that help you out? Yes, sir.
It's like the most effective way to adjust body part imbalances. Let's give you an example. My left lats here, I'm just a little more full than my right lats for sure. And, like, most people wouldn't be able to see that, but I stare at myself every day in the mirror, so like it's something that's constant.
How long do you stare at yourself in the mirror? It's a long time. I really think that if you train everything using free weights, dumbbells, things like that, I like a lot of balance. You know, I want to do, for example, if your lats are imbalanced, are you working things where you're not supporting yourself? For example, instead of doing a supported one-arm row, have you ever tried an unsupported one-arm row? You're activating all those little muscle fibers in between. You know, are you doing a lot of machines, a lot of things where you're sitting down? Try doing things standing. You know, there's certain things where you initiate the core. It's like, oh, you don't need balance for this. Like, I love doing straight leg deadlifts, one leg, one arm, and you come down, you come up. Why? Because you have to balance. That activates a lot of stuff. I'm not saying that's the fix-all, but it's not about size. It's about, like, you shouldn't train one more than the other, because then you create a physiological imbalance where, you know, it's kind of like that guy who trains chest all the time. It's like this. You know what I mean? You don't want to create that imbalance. So if you have a left arm doing the right arm, don't do 20 more curls in the right.
So I shouldn't be doing, like, more isolation movements in the leg, like, the bottom part, like the left leg, the right side?
No, I wouldn't train disproportionately at all. I think it'll even out over time with consistency. Did you? Okay, you had the question. Okay, we need more time.
What's the most common mistake you see with young entrepreneurs, and what can we do to avoid those mistakes?
Underestimating how much money it takes to start a business is the top mistake I think a lot of young entrepreneurs make. And also misunderstanding their industry and how it works. Yes, now
you. How do you know when you are ready to start a business, and how important is it to be ready mentally versus being ready financially?
Well, mentally, you got to be willing to put in that work. If you're not willing to work 18-hour days, it's not for you. If you're not ready to, you know, forego that free time, personal, and, you know, basically hanging out with your boys and playing video games, it's not for you. It's not for you. It's mainly mental. and it's mainly output. I've known a lot of people who've made businesses on $1,000 investment, who just grinded. So it's just, it's all on you and how much time you're willing to dedicate to that. But the money does help. But then again, money can be a downfall. If you watch Shark Tank, Mark Cuban always says, I want someone who's fighting, who has no choice but to fight. And there's something to be said about starting a company with nothing, because you respect it. When you're fighting for your life, it's amazing how strong you can be. Like, don't you think you'll run faster if someone with a knife is chasing you?
No.
That's what it is. That's what starting a business is. Someone's chasing you, trying to take everything you have that you've earned. Every day you own a business, there's someone working 24 hours a day, this is another Cuban quote, 24 hours a day trying to take everything you've worked for. That's what you have to know. And that's beyond financial. That's mental and that's spiritual. Yes, sir?
As far as the ratio of body weight to like protein, as far as like grams and pounds and all that, where do you feel is like the point of diminishing returns?
Well, I usually, in my diet, I start at like 2 grams per pound, but you go down to 1. 1 gram per pound, sweet spot. It is what it is, whether you're on stuff, off stuff. If you're a training athlete, whether you're a runner, a gram's just easy. You know, if it's a little bit over, that's fine, because if you take too much protein, I don't want you taking 2 grams of protein per pound and half a big go to gluconeogenesis. Gluconeogenesis, the conversion, is where the body converts protein to carbohydrate. So within the body, the liver, all that good stuff. So I think a gram per pound is just about right. And when you're eating carbs and fats, those actually spare your protein, because glucose is used for fuel. It's your body's preferred fuel source. And if you're on a ketogenic diet, it goes to ketones. So if you're eating carbs and fat to compensate, I think a gram per pound, I just go with the Journal of the International Society of Sport Nutrition, the ISSN. They're the only group of scientists for sport nutrition science. And so being that they recommend a gram per pound, I'm gonna say though, it's one of those where you go like, okay, those dudes are smart. Just roll with that. Yes, sir.
Thoughts on the use of carb cycling? Is it something that you...
I'm not a carb cycler, but it depends. I like free meals. Like, I like being able psychologically to say, hey, I like to tell people, hey, if it's like your wife's birthday or your kid's birthday, like the cake example we made before, like, don't be a dick. You know, and that spike in calories, that extra carbs, right? That's carb cycling. It's just not planned. I've never been one to have, I always find that I've tried it. I've tried every diet except for vegan, which I'm going to try. Because I feel as a diet guy, I need to try everything. And intermittent fasting. Those are two diets I've tried. I can't quite will myself to not eat that long. Maybe it's mental, maybe I will one day. But I have committed to doing vegan this year. But, you know, what was the question?
carb cycling.
Carb cycling, no. I don't like it. I was like, keto, shit. Forgive me. I really don't like how I feel when I do. And for me, it just messes me up. So for me, again, it's calories in, calories out. If I'm going to allow a higher carb day, again, have some yummy cereals. You know, don't be like, okay, I get an extra 3 green beans today. You know, if you're going to do something, you know, I'd rather have a free meal. And I'll throw refeeds in with my clients. But usually I don't think you need it like high, medium, like, what's a medium carb day? I like going, you know, here's your diet, and then every like seventh day or whenever, if I'm training, coaching someone personally, like if I see someone, I'm like, you know, they can probably, it's usually gut. Like, I bet you I can feed them some this week. So I'm like, you know, when's your next leg day? Thursday, cool. Eat an extra 300 grams of carbs. That's what it is for me. I'm just not a carb cycling guy, but it has its merits. I know a lot of people use it successfully. For me, diets aren't black and white. They're very gray. There's so many that work. I have one strategy I think is optimal, but it's not the only one that works. And different things work better. Again, like meal timing, like what do you prefer? What time of day should you train? What do you prefer? Because it's all about adherence. You could do the best thing in the world if you don't like it. Like full body training, like, oh, it's optimal, you'll gain more mass, but I hate it. I really despise doing like, okay, there's my 2 sets of squats, moving on. You know, it's like, I didn't even get a pump. You know, so it's psychological is a lot over optimal. Honestly, right now, I do a 4-day-a-week lifting split. This week's a little messed up. So Monday, I do upper body push, basically chest, shoulder, tricep. Tuesday is lower body push, leg day. Wednesday's off, or regen. That's where I do my foam rolling. I do a lot of athletic training, things like that. Thursday is upper body pull, back and bicep. rear delts. And then Friday is upper body pull. Upper body push. Upper body at lower body pull, which is deadlift hamstrings. Basically, squats or quads versus hamstrings. Back versus chest. So I section off like that. So lower body should at least get 50% of your time, in my opinion, because it's 50% of your body mass.
On your regen days, are you putting in as much time as you put into training for the foam?
Generally, it takes me about an hour, because I do 20 minutes of low-intensity cardio with it. Because I do a little bit of mini-band work, just get it loosened up, foam rolling. But, you know, like when I foam roll, like today, if those who went to the gym, I just foam roll basically the body parts I'm working, maybe a little adjunct back and lats, because those are involved in stabilization. But on regen day, I do it all. I pin roll everything. I do the lacrosse ball with my psoas, my hip. I'll drop a kettlebell right in here and really get the psoas. I mean, for me, a regen day is more important. You know, as you get older, it's more important than your training day. It's just as important. Regen is extremely important. Regen is basically recovery. Except XO is called regen. So I'm just using their shit. Just like we use ISSN. But I'm giving credit. I'm using Doug's stuff. I'm really not original. Yes, sir.
No,
it's good. It's good. I'm not going to be it.
What would you suggest if you have tight hip flexors? I know you're talking about foam rolling.
Mini bands. Mini bands. I have a good, it's called type in pillar prep, movement prep, and Lobliner on YouTube. Mini bands, they're basically mini bands. And you put, they start at yellow, it goes green, yellow, blue, black, I believe. I only use blue and black, I'm not trying to make gains. One around your knee, one around your ankles. Then you just like this. I always do opposite arm, opposite leg. It's a good mental thing to get into. Mini bands are awesome. Lacrosse ball, you'll find, just lay in the fetal position on the lacrosse ball. You'll know when you hit it because a sensation will shoot down your calf and you'll feel like you're gonna, like, it really hurts. That's when you know you've found the spot. Then you just lay there and you get your poker face on and you just sit through it.